Alright, so in our presentation, we've already mentioned Blue Zones a couple of times already, but I'll explain what the organization is. So Blue Zones is an organization which their motto is living longer based on the world's longest living communities. And when creating the Blue Zones, the founder kind of looked at, he looked around the world and he looked at all these different places in the world with, where people had unusually long lifespans. And he tried to find what do these places have in common. And some of the things that he found were the concepts that they mentioned are the right tribe concept, which is talking about having a really tight-knit community where people really know each other very well. He also talked about move naturally, which is kind of what we were talking earlier with the facts and myths about exercise, is they found that people who focused specifically on exercise for the sake of exercise often didn't live as long as the people who were doing exercise kind of integrated into their day, where they needed to walk a ways to go get food or to go get something else, and they had to walk back. And when that exercise was integrated into their daily life, they lived a lot longer. They also said eat wisely, so nutrition obviously affects lifespan heavily, and communities that have better nutrition live longer. And they also mentioned the right outlook, which was kind of like, it was a community-based thing, and it was also based on having some sort of like a purpose, and like a purpose in life, and like knowing where they're going. And that was really important. And we did an interview with the founder of Blue Zones. His name is Dan Butner. And he talked a lot about some of the fails that he had in wellness before he had started this project, and how the Blue Zones project helped him overcome these. He also talked about how longevity is really heavily based on environment. Obviously, there's some element of genetics in longevity, but longevity is really, your environment is so important when dealing with longevity. As well as having green space in a neighborhood, having walkability, and socializing with the people around you.
Our second interview was with the Apple Valley Mayor, Mary Hamlin Rowland. That's what she looks like. And in the interview, she made points about everything about healthy neighborhoods. But the main topic she always came back to was social cohesion and how that is the basis to a healthy neighborhood. She cried in our interview. So basically with like tears in her eyes, she talked about how her daughter was in the Peace Corps and how she touched so many lives by being in that organization. And then she related to her daughter's story to healthy neighborhoods by saying that once people learn that we are all the same, then that is when a truly positive community forms. And she also talked about National Night Out, and that's like the logo to it. And I don't know if your neighborhoods have it, but that is when a section of road is marked off. And firefighters and police visit like the neighborhood and the get-togethers where there's games and food and fun stuff like that. So she just talked about the National Night Out was a good outlet for social cohesion and bringing people together.
So for Eastview surveys, we studied 60 people, and we would write a sentence like, I feel safe in my neighborhood, and ask them to answer according to how much they agreed with the statement. And we found that 96.7% of those 60 students that took our survey said that they agreed or strongly disagreed that they felt safe in their neighborhood. And that just really reflects the suburbs around Eastview, which were most where our survey tookers lived, and it also can contribute to reflecting Eastview, because when you come from a safer neighborhood, you tend to promote a safer environment. We also wrote the statement, I have a lot of trash and or litter in my neighborhood, and we found that 83.3% of the students disagreed or strongly disagreed with this statement, and that once again shows that the neighborhoods around Eastview are fairly clean and probably reflects a little bit about Eastview too. We then asked them how many times per week that they use alternative ways of transportation, like walking and biking, rollerblading. And we found that half of the people who took the survey said that they walked or biked somewhere 1 to 2 times per week, which is good that we have people walking, but it's still a fairly low number, and I think it's very important that we encourage people to walk. And also be targeting the people that have their license specifically, because as you can see, 60% of the people who didn't walk or bike anywhere, they all had their license, and none of the people who walked 6 or more times per week had their license. So just target those people who have their license and really encourage them to walk specifically. We also correlated students who had their license according to how many times they ate fast food. And as you can see, the people people who don't have their license is half of what they do, of what people who do have their license, at 3 to 5 times per week and 6+ times a week. So once again, encourage everybody to eat less fast food, but target the people who don't have their license. We also ask people if they think their neighborhood has a lot of physical activity opportunities, and we found that most people put agree or disagree. And so we need to either assess the neighborhoods and maybe make more opportunities to be physically active, or promote them a little bit more so that people know that they're there.
So we have a little quote, and it's, home is where the heart is, so make it a good one.
So some determinants that we thought were important, but we also thought that were really difficult to impact by ourselves, were income. Income inequality in neighborhoods contributes massively to their quality. We looked in Minneapolis, and two neighborhoods just a couple of blocks away from each other had an income difference of $8,000 per year, like person to person. So that massively affects how neighborhoods are, but there's not really much we can do about that. Something else we found was education. In neighborhoods that have really great education systems and really great schools, the neighborhoods do tend to be better, but again, something that's really difficult to impact. Personal transportation, what we were talking about earlier with the surveys, people who walk around a lot more tend to be healthier and stuff like that. As well as fast food, obviously people who eat more fast food are less healthy, but proximity to fast food greatly affects the health of people and the health and how healthy they are in their neighborhood. Some determinants that we thought we could impact were walkability. So how is a neighborhood to walk around in, which we talked about earlier. Also the environment around the neighborhood. Where are there green spaces? How is the neighborhood itself? Social cohesion. How are the people to each other? Do they know each other? Have you ever like gone outside and talked to your neighbors, or do you just stay inside? As well as sanitation. So if there's trash and litter all around your neighborhood, you're a lot less likely to go out there and hang out and stuff like that.
All right, so for our determinant, an evolving environment in which the community lives in, we thought that a solution to this problem would be to simply just pick up litter and tidy up your community. And so whether it's just you, like you're walking around, you see trash and throw it away, or you actually like form a little group where you like you pick up trash on certain weekdays or on the weekend, all these things can just help better your community and better the quality of your community. So
for our social cohesion solution, we thought it would be good to organize like weekly block parties where people can go out and really get to know their neighbors on more of a personal level, and then in turn they can discuss ways to make their neighborhood healthier.
All right, and for our third impactful determinant, sanitation, we thought a good solution would be to set up pet waste stations. So for example, where I live, there's a lot of pet owners, especially dogs, and so what my office, like our office did, was they implemented these sort of pet waste stations, and at least what I've seen is that there's less people leaving like waste from their animals, and thus making our community cleaner and more sanitary. So
for our walkability solution, we thought it would be good to put rental bike systems around the neighborhood and city so that people could rent and ride, and it could also encourage them to be more physically active. And then it's also more environmentally friendly because it reduces the amount of carbon monoxide that's being released into the air by cars, which then can also have not only like the air pollution, but also plants and things like that. And then we can also have the proceeds go towards the city and support the city.
All right, so this is our video that we made, and we just kind of interviewed people and asked them to draw what their ideal neighborhood.